Good morning, church. First, let me just say I give thanks to God. I give thanks to God for Deacon Billy Young. I give thanks for all of the deacons, all of the leaders of First Baptist. Let's give them a round of applause. Let us glorify God in thanksgiving for their great work. It is my awesome privilege and honor to be able to be standing here with you in this sacred space on this sacred day when we are bringing together friends and family, friends into the house of the Lord and into this space that has been anointed and touched by God. It is my privilege this morning to stand up behind God's holy desk and to represent the Alabama African American Civil Rights Heritage Sites Consortium, of which First Baptist is a proud and founding member. Amen. I give thanks for being able to stand here behind the pulpit of the church of my beloved sister, Loretta Wembley. Miss Loretta, who keeps us all straight even when we don't need to be made even straighter, she finds a way out of no way. Y'all already know. Y'all testifying over there. I want to thank God for the opportunity to stand here alongside and to be in the sanctuary with my sister Miss Joyce O'Neill, Selma's own from Brown Chapel AME, but she is also the regional coordinator of the consortium. And I can call the formal connections, but I see y'all invited my family and my friends. I see Renata, I see Angela, I see family here. I see my family from Northern Heights Presbyterian Church that I pastored, the first church I ever pastored, right here in Selma, Alabama, going back to, I don't know when that was, 2007, I think. And so it is an honor and a privilege to be here with all of you, with so many of you, to see your faces, to be in representation of this organization which seeks to preserve historic structures, which seeks to protect authentic stories, which seeks to promote the promise of freedom, struggle, and empowerment that are connected to these sites in these places across the state of Alabama, because if we don't protect them, if we don't preserve them, if we don't promote them, they will be lost, they will disappear, and we will wonder, how did we get where we are, and how can we get to where we need to go? So it is my honor and privilege to represent the consortium and to represent my friends and my family, to represent my mama, who I know is watching on Facebook. Hey, mommy. But most importantly, it is my honor and my privilege and my responsibility to represent the Lord our God. Family, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, release to the captives, sight to the blind, liberation for all who are oppressed. So whoever it is that I represent, whatever it is names that I have behind my name, I serve the name that is above every name. And if I fall short of doing my best in that responsibility, I have failed. And so I ask that you pray for this preacher this morning. Sister Chestnut will tell you that, you know, Presbyterians don't always preach the way Baptists preached. But I'm going to reach. I'm going to get there. And somewhere in between, the Spirit of the living God is going to meet me. And somewhere in the midst of that, the Spirit of the living God is going to meet you. And it's going to speak to you. And it's going to speak through me. And we are going to have eyes that are going to be open. We are going to have ears that will hear. We're going to have hearts that receive. And we are not going to walk out of this sacred space the same way that we entered into it. So I give thanks to God right from the beginning. And so we begin, family, with a reading of the Word of God. We're going to talk about these chairs. And if you have some folding chairs, you may need to hold on to them because I think they run out of them on Amazon. There was a run at Walmart. But we're going to begin with a reading from the book of 2 Kings, the 13th chapter. If you will, I will read it, but if you could stand in reverence for the reading of the Word of God. I'm going to read 2 Kings chapter 13, starting at verse 14, and I'll read through to verse 19. And this is a passage of scripture that talks about the end of the prophet Elisha's life. We're going to talk about Elisha, and we're going to talk about the relevance of this time and this season in the life of Israel to what it is that we're dealing with right now in this country, in this state, in this city. But we will begin with 2 Kings chapter 13, verses 14 through 19. Now Elisha was fallen sick of his sickness, whereof he died. And Joash, the king of Israel, came down unto him and wept over his face and said, "Oh, my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof." And Elisha said to him, "Take bow and arrows." And he took unto him bow and arrows. And he said to the king of Israel, "Put thine hand upon the bow." And he put his hand upon it, and Elisha put his hand upon the king's hand. Verse 17, and he said, "Open the window eastward." And he opened it. Then Elisha said, "Shoot!" And he shot. And he said, "The arrow of the Lord's deliverance and the arrow of deliverance from Syria, for thou shalt smite the Syrians in Aphek till thou have consumed them." And he said, "Take the arrows." And he took the arrows. He took them. And he said unto the king of Israel, "Smite upon the ground." And he smote thrice. That means he smote, he hit it three times and stayed. And the man of God was wroth with him and said, "Thou shouldest have smitten five or six times. Then hadst thou smitten Syria till thou hadst consumed it. Whereas now thou shalt smite Syria, but three times." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, I read that in respect of the house from the King James Version. You may hear me jump back and forth, and I thank Sister for getting me the copy of the King James Bible. You may hear me jump to the NIV, the New International Version, the NRSV, the New Revised Standard Version. And if you hear it sound real familiar, I might switch to the LRSV, which is the Lukata's Revised Standard Version. They taught me to read Hebrew and Greek in seminary, so I may offer my own translation of the passage as well. Family, I will just begin with a title that has already been given. Inspired not by Martin Luther, the great reformer of the Protestant Church, not inspired by Martin Luther King, Jr., one of our heroes who made this space a base of operations for the freedom movement work, but from a different Luther, from Luther Vandross. Some of y'all knew the song, and I'm not going to sing it. I should get Brother Billy Young up here to sing it. But the Lutheran rendering that provides the title for this sermon, Luther said, a chair is still a chair, even if no one is sitting there. And I'm going to get to the rest of it. But please meditate with me for a few moments on the message. A chair is still a chair. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you for the blessing of this day. Thank you for the opportunity to come into your house amongst your people. In your name, Lord God, speak to me and through me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable and pleasing in your sight. Lord God, may the words that you give me make the comfortable be uncomfortable, Lord God. Let the words that you give to me, let those who are hurting, let them be comforted, Lord God. Let the bottom be the top and the top be the bottom, Lord God. Let me do what it is that you've called me to do on this day, in this place, in your name, in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray together and say together, amen. 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 So family, there's been a lot of talk about a viral moment caught on video. But before I even get to the viral moment captured on August the 5th, 2023, it shouldn't be a difficult stretch for some of us here at First Baptist Church of Selma to go back to an earlier viral moment before they were even calling it a viral moment. On the first Sunday in March, 1965, it was estimated that at one time, as they watched the evening news, 48 million people saw something happen on that bridge. They saw Amelia Boynton, they saw John Lewis, they saw Albert Turner, they saw other men and women whose names that they did not know expose the brutal, ugly face of racism and white supremacy. They saw the violence. They saw the injustice. They saw people who were seeking to stand up as a part of a movement calling for freedom being bloodied, but still not bowed. They called it Bloody Sunday. And we know Bloody Sunday. Bloody Sunday is a part of our roots. Bloody Sunday is a part of our DNA. Even though I wasn't born until 6 years after Bloody Sunday, it is something that has been a part of my life, of my identity, of my family, of my sense of self, of who I am and why I am and what I am. And so family, when I heard people calling August the 5th, 2023, Bloody Saturday, kind of got to me a little bit at first, because it was different. See, one of the things that was different, and this I must confess was something that made me feel good. So oftentimes when we see these viral videos, like we saw back in 1965, what we see are folks like Sheriff Jim Clark and white people beating down black people, defenseless, unable to stand up, and then that's the beginning of the video, and that's the end of the video. And when I first started watching the video from August the 5th, I said, here we go again. First, they were calling our brother out of his name. They were calling him a security guard. He wasn't no security guard. He's not a security guard. He's a co-captain, a dot captain, Damian Pickett. And he did something a little familiar. You know, when I saw him toss that cap, I knew what that meant. Some of y'all didn't know, but I knew exactly what it meant. But then I saw something familiar. Cap or not, he was getting whooped, no cap. He was being overwhelmed, he was being beaten. But then, and let me say this, and beaten by what has been called and what needs to be called a group of drunken white thugs. And I'm not going to blame it on the alcohol, because they were drunk on white supremacy before they took a sip that day. People are drunk on racism before they even fill up the glass. So I saw this white mob, this crowd of thugs beating down this black man, Damian Pickett. And I said, here we go again. But then I saw what they call Black Aquaman. Aquaman, Scuba Gooding Jr., Swimmy Hendrix. I even added one, I'm gonna call him Swimmy Lee Jackson. Because like the Jimmy Lee Jackson that we know from the Black Belt, Jimmy Lee Jackson stood up for somebody. Jimmy Lee Jackson saw injustice. Jimmy Lee Jackson said, this is unacceptable. Jimmy Lee Jackson saw brutality against his family and he needed to respond. So I call him Swimmy Lee Jackson. And this brother, I don't want to say Aaron, Aaron Rudolph, I saw Aquaman, 16 years old, jump in the water. And I said, oh, something's different. This is not the same. Now, I mean, I knew black people could swim. That wasn't a surprise to me. Some of y'all said, oh, well, black people can't. No, I know black people can swim. I know it's a lie of white supremacy that says that black people don't have any buoyancy and we just sink to the bottom. That ain't the truth. Y'all just don't put no swimming pools in our neighborhoods, and so we don't have the opportunity to learn to swim. We don't have a YMCA like y'all have. But when I saw this Aquaman jump in this water, and I heard the commentary of the sister as he moved across that water from that boat going to that dock, I said, oh, there's something different here. And as I continued to watch the rebellion at the riverfront, I saw some things that were different, but I also saw some things that were familiar. See, I know about R.C. Hatch High School. I've spoke at a graduation there, and I saw them purple shirts. Some of y'all thought it was Omega Psi Phi, thought it was the Bruhs, but no. That's the class of 1975 of R.C. Hatch High School in Uniontown, Alabama. And what I saw was what we call old man strength. And I said it that way, strength, not strength, old man strength that showed up in defense of, on behalf of a black man who was being beaten and abused. And it didn't stop there. It went from Aquaman, it went from the Black Avengers that came off the boat, it went to R.C. Hatch class of 1975. Y'all calculate how old them brothers were if they graduated from high school in 1975. And then they got all the way around to Brother Reggie Ray with that chair. And I'll confess to you, and y'all can say this is not something that a preacher's supposed to say, it made me feel good. It made me feel good for a bad reason. Because too often, we have not seen black people stand up for black people. Too often, we are afraid of one another. Too often, we watch these viral videos which begin with us getting beat up and end with us being beat down. And so when I looked at it and I saw him pick up that chair, and I didn't think he was especially skilled. He was kind of moving around. He even hit one brother by accident in the back one time. There was all kinds of things happening in the video. I wasn't looking for a choreographed cinematography here. I saw a brother who wanted to respond because he saw injustice and he was filled with rage. And yes, we made all kinds of memes and jokes and we give nicknames to our people. So Scuba Gooding Jr. And my favorite was Sharkus Garvey that we gave to brother Aaron Rudolph. But I remembered the words of one of the black theologians that inspired me in my study at seminary. The father of black liberation theology, James Cone, Dr. James Cone, talked about the relationship between anger and humor. He said anger and humor are like the left and the right arm. They complement each other. Anger empowers the poor to declare the uncompromising opposition to oppression, but you can't just throw a left and a left and a left and a left all the time. The right arm is humor. And humor is that uppercut that prevents us from being consumed by our fury. So we needed balance. We could throw a left and a right. We could do Radio Raheem from the movie Do the Right Thing, love and hate. And again, it's not to say this is a good thing, but if we do, we say it's a good thing for a bad reason. But family, I kept on thinking. After the anger, I kept on thinking. After the laughter, and I was watching all the stuff that Angela Benjamin was posting on her Facebook page and all the things that were being put out there and found out there was another Selma connection right here when we want to look at this drunken crowd that was drunken on white supremacy. We saw that they were close to home. But as I thought about it, and I saw people, there was a picture, somebody instead of having a holstered firearm had a holstered folding chair on their hip. I saw a picture that back in the day, it was a picture of Malcolm X who was looking out the window with a rifle, but there was a brother holding the folding chair. And I had to say, hold up, wait a minute. We got to put some God in it. Because a chair is still a chair. A chair is not going to take us where we need to go. A chair is what we can focus on in the moment. In the viral video that we put together, we may get 2 or 3 minutes, but a chair is still a chair. And so then I went to the Word. And I said, what thus saith the Lord? What does the Lord have to say about this passion, this emotion, this anger, this attempt, this rebellion at the riverfront? What does the Word have to say about a chair? Don't say, oh, well, Pastor, you're not going to find nothing in Holy Scripture about no folding chair. That wasn't even invented yet. And there was all the information. There was a black man that invented the folding chair. They got the patent for the folding chair. You're not going to find nothing about that in Holy Scripture. But I said, well, all Scripture is God-breathed. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in all righteousness. And so when I went and looked and I said, let me see if I can find a chair, I had to go a little deeper. I said, let me see where God uses something ordinary, something that isn't designed for this particular purpose, and uses it in extraordinary ways. And when I stepped back and I said, let me look in that way, the Scripture opened up to me for correction, for teaching, for reproof in all righteousness. And the first thing that the Spirit led me to in Scripture was Samson. A jawbone is still a jawbone. But Samson used the jawbone of a donkey. I won't use the other word. Samson used the jawbone of a donkey in order to slay the Philistines. But even before that, Moses. Not the Moses played by Charlton Heston. Not the Moses with blonde hair and blue eyes. But God used a walking stick, a staff, in order to reveal the power and the promise of God. God said to Moses, what's in your, I can't do it. I can't talk. I can't go down there and talk to those Egyptians. I can't go down there and talk to those people. Don't you know they own a mini mart? Don't you know that they got power and control and influence? They can cause harm to me. And God said to Moses, what's in your hand? And God took that ordinary thing and transformed it into something extraordinary so the powers could see. I continued to look in Scripture and I saw David, shepherd, unremarkable relative to his brothers. God took a small, smooth stone and a slingshot and brought down Goliath. Last week I preached, God took two fish and five loaves, lifted them up to God, gave thanksgiving, organized the people. Y'all need to go back and read that scripture. Organized them into groups of 50 and was able to feed 5,000 men plus all the other women and children who were there. And the miracle, the extraordinary work is greater than what it is that we have imagined. So then I started to think about this chair. Because certainly it was an ordinary thing that was used for what has come to be extraordinary purposes and notoriety. Millions and millions of people have watched Brother Reggie swing that chair. But as I prayed, I said, we need more than this moment. A moment is not a movement. How many people did he hit? Three? I don't know, thrice? I know one brother he hit on accident, but swung the chair thrice, on thrice people, on three people. But do we need more? Is that moment enough, even though we're inspired, even though our anger and our humor comes together, even though we finally get to feel good about seeing black people fight back? Is it enough? And in 2 Kings in the 13th chapter, the prophet Elisha says to the king, it is not. Elisha has something to teach us. And Elisha was a successor. Elisha was the one that came after Prophet Elijah. But if we look closely, he did double or even quadruple the number of miracles that Elijah is said to have done. But Elisha came after Elijah went off in the chariot of fire into the heavens. And Miss Loretta, where'd she go? She went downstairs. Ms. Joyce, we are the successors. We are the Elishas. We can talk about those who organize the mass meetings here. We can talk about those who marched across the bridge in 1965. We can talk about those who were a part of the Dallas Voters League. We can talk about our ancestors who went before us, but we are the successors. We have a responsibility right now in this moment to make a movement. And Elisha said to the king, you got an enemy ahead of you. You got Syrians that are approaching. You need to get ready to advance. You need to do the work. He said, take a bow and arrows. And he said, shoot. And he shot an arrow over Syria to the east. He shot an arrow which symbolized the victory. He shot an arrow which gave him a moment to see what it could look like. And it had to feel good. Because Israel had been through some things. Israel had been under empire after empire after empire. Israel had gone through so much. And so that symbolic arrow shot out of the window to the east was a symbolic measure that said that victory can and will be won. But then Elisha said, now I need you to strike. Now, some people read this and they read it as that he hit the arrows on the ground. Some say that instead of shooting up, he started shooting down. One strike, two strikes, three strikes. But he said, strike. And the king just did, I'm done. You ain't see how I whooped them. You ain't see what I did with that chair. You can call me Aquaman. Old man strength, R.C. Hatch. But then Elisha said, why'd you stop? If you hadn't stopped, if you hadn't realized, if you had just realized it was more than just, you would have kept on. And the victory would have been won, and the enemy would have been consumed. I need to say to Brother Reggie, I need to say to my families and friends on Facebook, Angela, we need to tell all of those who are still coming up with new names for Swimmy Hendrix and Scuba Gooding and Sharkus Garvey and Chairman that a chair is still a chair. Now let me get into some Luther. He said a chair is still a chair even if no one is sitting there. He said, but a chair is not a house. And a house is not a home. And he talks about if there's certain things that are not present inside of the house, if there's certain things that are not there, if there's not love, if there's not care, if there's not consistency, if there is not labor inside of the house, it will never be a home. And if all we're doing is, you see how I whooped that white man? You see how I swung that chair? You see how I did that breaststroke? The chair will just be a chair. The house will not be a home. There is something more that is required when we look to the story of Elisha. Before he even picked up and began to aim the bow and arrow, Elisha put his hands on top of the bow. Oh, family, I'm not ashamed to say it. If we are going to win, if we are going to do the work that we need to do, if we are going to go beyond just having another bloody Saturday or another bloody Sunday, we are going to have hands laid upon us. We are going to have the Spirit of the living God falling fresh and upon us. We are going to have to be anointed and know that this is not just our fight. This is not just our struggle. This is not just our victory, but victory belongs to God, and it did not begin with us. We are a continuation of a movement. Bloody Sunday 1965 was a continuation of a movement. It didn't start on that bridge. We were already organizing. We were already mobilizing. We were already taking risks. We were already standing up and speaking out. We already showed our courage. It didn't take Jim Clark to beat us on television in order for us to show that we were people of God. We were already blessed. We were already anointed. We were already appointed for the assignment. And we have to connect with that today. We don't just need another Bloody Sunday. We need a mobilized Monday. We need a turn up Tuesday. We need a wise counsel Wednesday. We need to throw the monkey off your back Thursday. We need a Freedom Friday. And we need a sit in Saturday in between the Sabbath so that we can get back to Sunday to be restored and to be renewed to continue the work that we need to do. Look at the video, but look more closely. Ms. Joyce, people are wanting to come down now. We're getting all kinds of calls. I want to come visit Alabama now. And I want to go to, what's that called, a riverfront? And I want to pose with a folding chair. I said, brother, a chair is still a chair. But that space, there is a legacy. That space is where our people were bought and sold as products. That space is dripping with blood before Saturday, August 5th. That place is where my mama was sold this way. My daddy was sold this way. My brothers and sisters were divided up and sold as property like a cow or a horse. And let me also say this. We didn't just start fighting in 2023. We always want to imagine that white supremacy just came and picked us up and brought us from Africa and brought us over here, and we didn't do nothing. We had Aquamanes back hundreds of years ago that jumped off of slave ships and said, I'm swimming back home. And if I don't make it, it's better to be at the bottom of an ocean than be at the bottom of this slave ship. We have been fighting. We have been organizing. We have been resisting from the very beginning, and we need to know the whole story. We've been fighting a long time. We've been fighting from the very beginning. And if we will begin to fight on behalf of one another, if we will begin to see, you know what? That's my family, even though we ain't got no blood. If we will begin to see that I am because we are. We are because I am. If we will see that we are an interwoven fabric connected one to the other, and when one of us is hurting, all of us are hurting. If one of us is getting beat down, all of us are getting beat down. If we will see that we can come together, then we will recognize that we have more available to us than just a chair. First of all, we have God. Did y'all not notice the presence of God? There wasn't a shot fired. In an open carry state, black people didn't shoot nobody. White people didn't shoot nobody. I was stunned. I'm looking at the police. The police ain't shooting nobody. Not a shot was fired. Not a life, whether it be black or white or young or old. There's some people that came away with some headaches, but that's the way we used to fight. You knuckle up, knuck if you buck. But on that day, there was not a life lost. And family, we forget to glorify God. Angela, of all the memes that I saw, I didn't see one that said, to God be the glory. Thank God for Scuba Gooding Jr. Thank God for Swimmy Lee Jackson. Thank God for Old Man Strength. Thank God for Brother Reggie. Thank God for using the folding chair. To God be the glory. Even though we can be imperfect with God's blessing, God will bless us in certain ways, and we may not always use it rightly, but God gives us a blessing so we can be protected to do the work that we need to do. Know this, our ancestors were not perfect. Dr. King made mistakes. The civil rights movement leaders made errors. Our churches had contradictions. But God continued to bless us anyway, and we must continue to press on and to push on because God is with us. The word teaches us that. The word teaches us that we can know that the Spirit of the Lord is upon us. But we also have to know when we study Scripture. And as we prepare to handle God's blessing, are we ready for the backlash and the retaliation? Come on now. Grassroots racist, and y'all know about some of them, they don't just go away. They just don't go off into the night bruised up. Oh, they coming for us. Good you got a black mayor in Montgomery. Good you got a black chief of police. Good, good, good. But you about to have some good, good trouble. And there will be backlash. There will be retaliation. There will be those that will come for us, whether it be in Montgomery, whether it be in Selma, whether it be Aquaman, I understand it's from Birmingham, whether it be anywhere else in the United States, because that same weekend, the Orange Menace was in town. And the spirit of the orange was upon them. And the spirit of the orange thought that they could just get away with, oh, in a small town. Well, you know, y'all didn't know Montgomery ain't a small town. And you best not even try that in Uniontown. I remember, I don't know if it's changed, Angela, but back in the day, they had one stoplight. I did not stop at that stoplight in Uniontown. I kept it moving. But they got another one now? They still got that one. You don't try that in Uniontown either. But family folding chairs are not going to be adequate to protect us. Folding chairs are not going to preserve us. What we are going to need is more than a chair, and what we're going to need, in all honesty, is more than a closed-eyed prayer. I said it. We got to pray with open eyes. We got to do like what Miss Loretta said on my favorite words on the Voices of Alabama series that goes back and looks at the state at the sites of the consortium. She said the movement at First Baptist was 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. What we have to realize is we need more than a chair. We need more than a prayer. We need organization. We need resources. We need people who are going to come together. We need people who are more than Facebook warriors with Twitter fingers and Instagram agendas. We need people who are going to say, you know what? We need to fill up this church again. We need to mass mobilize in this church again. We need to learn from our successes, learn from our mistakes, learn from what went wrong, and get it better this time. Because the struggle is eternal. It is not just about a series of moments. It's a movement. I'm looking for the movement memes. I'm looking for the Legal Defense Fund memes. I'm looking for how we gonna organize so we can prevent this from happening in the future. How can we stop the violence within our communities, whether that be from us, whether that be from police, whether that be from the forces of white supremacy, in whatever form, because I am because we are, and we are because I am. I'm gonna close it up here. Because there's something that happens. There's something that happens at the end of the story that I read from 2 Kings from the 13th chapter. And if you continue to read on past verse 19 and you go to verses 20 and 21, after Elisha has given these instructions, after Elisha says that you have to keep on, after Elisha says you have to press on until the victory is won, then Elisha dies. And he's buried. He's put in a hole. And undoubtedly, they felt the way we have felt when some of our ancestors have been called on. Maybe they were thinking about building monuments and memorials. Maybe they were thinking about how they would remember those who had gone before them, and they were having a funeral for one of their own who had died. And while they were planning the funeral, while they were organizing and preparing to put the dead man into the tomb on top of the bones of Elisha, the enemy was approaching. And if you read the scripture, and it's somewhat an obscure text, but if you read the scripture, what it says is that as soon as they put the dead man on top of Elijah's bones and he touched the bones, it says the dead man stood up. When he connected with the ancestors, he was able, in the face of the enemy, he was able to stand up. There's a word for somebody in here, and I want to make sure you get all of it. That if we can connect with the bones of our ancestors, when I grab a hold of this holy desk, when I stand in this sacred space, when you sit in those hallowed pews, when we come into the places where our ancestors have been and struggled, it can inspire us, it can motivate us, it can encourage us to stand up in the face of opposition. But I want you to get the whole story. It said that the dead man stood up, but the dead man couldn't fight. That is still upon us who are living. A dead general cannot lead a living army. A perished prophet cannot propel an oppressed people forward in their struggle. We can be inspired. We can be motivated. We can be encouraged. We can be instructed. We can be anointed. We can be given directions. Fire and shoot the arrow. Strike, strike, strike. But at the end of the day, we have to make it go from a moment to a movement. It is our responsibility to turn to our brothers and sisters and say, I'm with you. I felt good. I watched that video. They say it's been viewed tens of millions of times. I know I got at least 10,000 on it. But a chair is still a chair. We need organization. We need resources. We need people standing up ready to fight. I know some of you all don't like it. Some people have been out there protesting and boycotting. You know what? If you don't like that, then what are you going to do? Because I'm tired of the Twitter fingers. I'm tired of the Facebook warriors. I'm tired of those who just want to talk the talk but don't know how to walk the walk. All you can do is limp. All you can do, a chair is just a chair, and you just want to sit there. You're not going to pick it up. You're not going to fight. You're not going to organize. You're not going to mobilize. But that is our responsibility. Ancestors can bear witness. They can inspire. But they cannot fight for us. We have to connect with the bones. Help our people to stand up. And then we go and we show them how to get up out of that chair. How to grab hold of all of the talents and the resources that we need so that God will get the glory. And we won't just simply win a few battles, but we will be ready to win the war. Amen.